Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Larry, who we haven't seen for a while. It's great to have you.
Well, I didn't think it was open.
Oh, yeah. Here we are. And welcome to you who are watching at home, and we'll keep in our hearts all those who are not able to come and those who are in our group. Group. We never should have organized a system so complicated. So again, this is our morning service of morning prayer. There'll be more news later on, but I think the most exciting thing is that we have been given permission by the diocese to begin Holy Eucharist again. Yay! So not quite yet, but we're getting there. So we're going to do. We'll announce it, and it's in our new newsletter that we will do that on the last Sunday of this month. So that's the 30th of August.
No, 23rd. Was it not the 23rd?
Our picnic?
Yeah.
Oh, I will converse quietly.
Okay, sorry. Stay tuned.
Let's take a few moments as we prepare ourselves for worship and listen to our pulpit. May Christ dwell in our hearts through faith, that we, being rooted and grounded in love, may have power to comprehend what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses all knowledge. I will bless our God at all times. God's praise shall ever be in my mouth. O magnify our God with me.
Let us exalt God's name together.
Glory to God, our Creator, to God's most holy work, and to the Spirit indwelling, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Worship God in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us adore. All the earth cries out with joy to you.
serving you with gladness, coming before you, singing for joy. You, Creator of all, our God, you made us, we belong to you. We are your people, the sheep of your flock. We go within your gates giving thanks, entering your courts with songs of praise. We give thanks to you and bless your name. Indeed, how good you are, O God. Eternal your merciful love. You are faithful from age to age. Worship God in the beauty of holiness.
Come, let us adore.
Responsive psalm reading today is number 85, verses 8 to 13. I will read the light print, and you are invited to respond with the bold. Show us your mercy, O God, and grant us your salvation.
I will listen to what you are saying, for you are speaking peace to your faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to you.
Truly, your salvation is very near to those who fear you, that your glory may dwell in our land.
Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other.
Truth shall spring up from the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven.
God will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase.
Righteousness shall go before you, and peace shall be a pathway for your feet.
Glory to God, our Creator, to God's most holy word, and to the Spirit indwelling, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
The first lesson is from Romans chapter 10, verses 5 to 15. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, and so is justified. And one confesses with the mouth, and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news.
We respond together with the first canticle, a song of God's grace. The glorious grace of God is freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. Blessed are you, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for you have blessed us in Christ Jesus with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. You chose us to be yours in Christ before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before you. In love,
you destined us to be your children, through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of your will.
To the praise of your glorious grace, which you freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. In you we have redemption through the blood of Christ and forgiveness of sins. According to the riches of your grace, which you have lavished upon us, you have made us known to us, in all wisdom and insight, the mystery of your will. According to your purpose, which you set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in Christ, things in heaven and things on earth. The glorious grace of God is freely bestowed on us in the Beloved.
The second lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew.
Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking towards them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost," and they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened and began to sink. And he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Our response to the gospel reading is the second canticle, a song of mercy and grace, written by Julian of Norwich. God is the light and the grace, which is all blessed love. Jesus is our true mother, the protector of the love which knows no end. We have our being from Jesus, where the foundation of motherhood begins. God revealed that in all things, as truly as God is our father, so truly God is our mother. God is the power and goodness of fatherhood. God is the wisdom and loving kindness of motherhood. God is the Trinity, and God is the Unity. God is all our life, nature, mercy, and grace. God is the one who makes us to love, and the endless fulfilling of all true desires. For where the soul's highest and noblest, then it is humble and lowly. God desired Christ to be our mother, our brother, and our Savior. For God knows us now and loved us before time began. In nature, Jesus is our true mother by our first creation, and in grace by taking our created nature. All the love of offering and sacrifice of beloved motherhood are in Christ our Beloved. For in Jesus we have this godly will, both in nature and in grace. God is the light and the grace, which is all blessed love. May I speak to you this morning in the name of the one who created
Okay, if you close your eyes, you can see it, right? Jesus walking on the water. That has to be one of the most well-known, and I would even say cliche, images of Jesus. If you've been around me long enough, you know that my first teaching was not in Sunday school, but when my sister took me to see Jesus Christ Superstar, because I was raised in an atheist household, and my dad would have none of it. But my sister took me to the movie, and I'll never forget Pilate singing, "Jesus, prove to me that you're no fool, walk across my swimming pool." That was very strange for a young 10-year-old. But that image of Jesus, if you look it up on the internet, Jesus walking on water, you can see dozens, maybe hundreds, or dozens of images of this story. He's usually a white guy with a blonde hair or blue eyes. But anyway, no comment. But let's look at this story again. Let's try to sink deeper into the story, no pun intended. But let's really dig our teeth into it and think about what this story is trying to tell us. Now, I know you all, those who work here, dutifully watched the video from last week, so you know what we were talking about last week, right? Don't have to confess, it's all right. We were talking about the feeding of the 5,000. Now, it does say 5,000 and women and children. I wonder about that story, but anyway, we'll leave that again for another day. Jesus starts that story in distress, and he's going away to pray by himself because he has just received the news. The reading last week doesn't say what the news was. You have to go in and dig around and find a little bit about it. But the news that he received was that his teacher, the man that had baptized him, the man who had come before him to open the way for him, John the Baptist, had been murdered. Remember, John was murdered by Herod. When Jesus receives this news, he withdraws to pray. But while he was praying, the crowds come to him anyways. So he's not given any time to pray about this terrible loss and what it might mean for him. Then he feeds everyone, and we're left with that wondering, how is it possible that in this crowd of 5,000, 10,000, 15,000, there was enough? There was enough bread, there was enough fish, there was enough water, we presume. So after that amazing story, Jesus again sends off his disciples. Maybe this is the time he will be able to pray. He dismisses the crowd. I wonder how he did that. I wonder what he said to them after that great feast. Doesn't tell us. And then he goes by himself up a mountain. The disciples are on the Sea of Galilee. They have been struggling in the wind all night. And early in the morning, Jesus comes to them walking on the sea. And he says to them, "Take heart." Peter, we know, is kind of a stand-in for many of us. Peter is the disciple that's always getting it wrong, that's promising things, yet going back on his promises, that is confused and mixed up, and in the end is the one who denies Jesus, but then in the end is the one who carries the church into the next age. So Peter questions, and then with enthusiasm, he gets out of the boat and starts to go to Jesus. And then he has a second thought when the wind hits his face. He doubts. He is frightened, and he begins to sink. And then it says, Jesus immediately reaches out to Peter. I don't know if you've noticed, if you look back on the text, you can see Jesus says three times in this short text, immediately. It's an urgent thing. He reaches out. He reaches out and grabs Peter's hand, and together they go into the safety of the boat where the storm is calmed. Now, some of us are reading a book this month that Martha is leading us in studying called Confronting Christianity. Kind of an interesting book. It's not exactly what I thought, but it's helpful, I think, in that it's provoking me to think, and it's provoking me to defend some of the things I think about that the writer of this book thinks about differently. We are on the same path in some moments and then very divergent in others. And I value the opportunity to stir it up, because if we just read who we agree with all the time, then we don't get any deeper into our faith, I believe. One of the things we agree with, and she's writing from an evangelical point of view, one of the things that she says, which might be shocking for people in her community, that is not shocking to anybody who goes to the Vancouver School of Theology to study theology, is that we're not supposed to take the stories of Jesus literally. Our faith does not depend on Jesus actually walking on water, some physics beyond belief that Jesus could do this thing, that he could walk across the swimming pool, that he could do whatever he wanted. That's not the point. We do not have to believe that Jesus walked on the water if we want to be Christians. We can understand it as a metaphor. We can understand it as a teaching story that is pointing towards something profound and true, even if we don't believe the physics of a 33-year-old man walking across the water. So what does Jesus point towards? What does this story teach us about Jesus? Anybody seen that bumper sticker? Maybe it was from the 70s more, just Jesus saves. That's what the whole point of this story is. Jesus saves. Jesus immediately saves. So that leaves me to wonder, what kind of storms does Jesus save us from? What kind of storms have you faced in your life? Have you faced loss? Have you faced fear? Have you faced addiction? Have you faced loneliness? Have you been a refugee? Have you been rejected? Maybe none of those big things, maybe small things have been storms in your life. My neighbor, who's from Serbia, just lost her mother in Serbia to COVID. She's a non-believer, but she and I sat for quite some time before she flew back home to figure out what to do. She couldn't see her mother alive, but she had to go home and figure out what to do with the afterwards. I remembered and I reflected on when my mother died and how that was the biggest loss of my life so far. I couldn't imagine life without my mother. So imagine in the storm of your life, whatever it is, big or small, imagine a burst of hope that takes away all that fear, all of it. Imagine being brave enough to step not away from the storm, but into the storm. Imagine then doubting. Imagine drowning. Imagine being overcome with anxiety. Then imagine being saved again, not just the first time, but the second time, in the midst of your deepest storm. Imagine the water being calm.
This story today is pointing towards a deep truth that cannot be taken away from us once we understand and know it. Julian of Norwich says simply, all shall be well. All shall be well. And all manner of things shall be well. God knows us. God knew us from before we were born, even from the moment of our creation and from before that. Jesus, like a mother, knew us and loved us. In the normal Anglican service of Holy Communion, we say the collect for purity. God, from whom all desires flow, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts, and on and on. We'll say that again in a few weeks. But imagine, there are secrets in our hearts that maybe we've never even told our spouses or our children or our parents or our best friends. God knows them. And that's not something to be afraid of. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts. These days of challenge, these days of wondering and confusion and storms, whether large or small, we can nourish our faith in this circle, in this place, in this church. We can nourish and sustain one another through the storm, knowing and hearing and clearing out our ears again to hear again if we need to. The word is very near you. It is on your lips and in your heart. In order to say yes to Christ, in order to be a Christian, you don't have to have the whole thing figured out. You don't have to be a great intellectual, thank heavens. You don't have to have 5 PhDs. You don't have to understand it. All you have to do, and maybe you have to do it more than once, maybe you have to do it again and again and again, maybe every moment before you go to sleep or every moment when you get up to face the day, maybe you do have to turn to God and just say yes. Yes to God, even if it feels like you are drowning, even if the world is turned upside down, even if you've lost more than you can ever imagine, you can say yes, and that yes will carry you to the other side. And no matter where we are on our life journey, we have work to do too. Did you hear Paul's word in the letter to the Romans? We have to tell people about our wonderful good news. And there's hope that they will believe and love and have peace. The last words from Paul's letter that we read today are from Prophet Isaiah. How beautiful are the feet, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the words of peace. My prayer for you this week and this month, say yes and walk towards Jesus and don't be afraid.
dedicate ourselves to God. Proverbs 3 verse 5 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desire of your heart. Commit your ways to the Lord. Trust in him and he will act. As we commit ourselves to God, I will say, O God, our Savior, please respond with, hear our prayer. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we pray for you to continually shower your grace on us. We have often wronged you and our fellow humans. We thank you for your surpassing grace that saves and cleanses us from all our iniquities. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
Merciful and ever-loving God, we commit your church on earth to your care. Make us your children to understand that your Son, Jesus Christ, suffered and died on the cross that we may be saved. That everyone whom you have called may show forth the power of his resurrection. Renew the spirit and hope in every human. Renew the spirit and hope in every society, in every community and every nation. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we commit to you the people of Lebanon and especially the people of Beirut. The recent explosions have claimed the lives of many. Many of your children are hurting. Many have lost their jobs. Many have lost properties. We pray for the peaceful repose of the souls of the deceased. We pray that you comfort those who have lost loved ones and friends. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
God, we continue to commit to you our healthcare workers who are risking their lives daily to save us. We continue to commit to you the sick, especially those sick from the coronavirus. We commit to you the families of all who have lost loved ones as a result of the coronavirus pandemic. We pray for all the deceased. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
God, we bring to you in prayer all the small businesses that are struggling at the moment. We pray for all the people who have lost their jobs. We pray that they may have peace of mind and that the support which they need so badly at this moment may come sooner. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for our church at St. Barnabas. It has not been easy figuring out how to run the worship service in your house in the midst of this pandemic. But we thank you for your continuous guidance and wisdom which you have imparted in our leaders to do the best in bringing your gospel to your people. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all who cannot make it to church because they are vulnerable. We pray for all who follow the worship service online. We pray that you will bless them and they will continue to be part of the St. Barnabas family. And that sooner rather than later, we will be able to meet in person like we used to do. O God, our Savior,
hear our prayer.
Giver of life, please continue giving us your children the strength, the wisdom, and the willpower to have steadfast faith in you despite these trying moments. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We continue in prayer by saying the words of the prayer that Jesus taught us. Let us say, Our Father in heaven,
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Show us your mercy, O God,
and grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace in all the world,
for only you can we live in safety.
Keep this nation under your care,
and guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth,
your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy be forgotten,
nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God,
and sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
Let us pray together the collect appointed for this Sunday. O God, the protector of all who trust in you,
without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy,
increase and multiply on us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit,
one God,
forever and ever.
Amen.
And the collect for Sunday. O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And the collect for mission, which we pray for all those, especially those not able to be here for whatever reason. Loving God,
from birth to death, you hold us in your hand. Make us strong to bear each other's burdens and humble to share our own, that as one family, we may rest in your power and trust in your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom of God.
How unsearchable are your ways.
From God and to God are all things.
To you be the glory forever.
Amen. Listen to one more hymn.
Thank you.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and in the love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Mother, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
So, a few notices. Martha has been doing an amazing job. Thank you, Martha, making the church work. Basically, if it weren't for Martha, the church would have collapsed at this point.
No.
Martha's been like holding the fort and paying the bills and tracking down those weird people in our diocesan office who just are very confusing. So thank you, Martha. And this is the second bulletin. Thank you. And there is a typo.
Yes, sorry. It was the 30th. I got mixed up.
Indeed, the picnic is not the 23rd. So just take it home. Everything else except for the 23rd is true. Just write the 30th.
It's the 30th. I'll send a revised one around.
We'll revise it.
Yeah, we'll revise it. Sorry.
Just note for yourself. That's okay. But yes, please come, everybody. It's a BYOP. Sorry, we should really work on
the 23rd.
Yeah, there's something wrong with this microphone. But that day, we're planning all of us to be together, God willing, the weather will work. If it doesn't, we can fit most of us in the parish hall in little clumps as well. And we do have permission as of 2 weeks from now, actually next week, to do Holy Eucharist. But we've decided to wait until this day when we'll start it, and we'll invite everybody to come together. So it's bring your own picnic. There won't be sharing or touching food, but we can sit more or less together. And I guess that's it. The sacred singing circle will be that day in the afternoon, so you could rush home and plug into Zoom. And Jill has tried it once or twice. It's kind of interesting. Sorry about that. I am turned off. I don't know why it's doing that. Yep, it's off. I don't know. Anyway, our service for this day. Lovely to see you. We'll see you in 2 weeks. But as I've told the other group as well, if you feel so inclined to come and it's not your week, we can actually fit up to 20 people in here. We have had 17. That's been our maximum number. We've had 11. We've had 12. So if everybody comes together, it would be a little bit squishy. But if you really want to come to church and it's not your week, you can come. Just maybe you could let us know, but there'll always be room for a few more. So let us go in peace to love and serve.